Bob Graham will be back. He'll be back like when WMCA fired him, I think, many years ago. Como got him back. But this is great. All the...
Is that Perry Como?
Come on, you know.
I know.
Anyway,
I know.
But all the letters coming in, phone calls, very good with the book. ABC's a shrewd operator. When he does come back, he's going to be on like Rush Limbaugh. But anyway, talking about people calling Michael Eisner, Disney, do they really think that Michael Eisner and Disney, the Disney Corporation, they bought ABC, rather Capital Communications, for $12 billion. It's a $30, $40 billion company that Michael Eisner got time to be concerned about this. You got more important things to do. Plus the fact, the main fact I want to bring out is, you take big corporations like Disney, they're going to go for Republicans. Republicans are for big business. You take Exxon, Philip Morris, and Disney, and AT&T, you think they're going to, you know what they do? They give money, these big companies, they give money to the Democrat Clinton. They'll give money to Dole to play it down the middle. But they always favor Republicans. Republicans, you know... they're going to fare the big corporations.
All right, George, thank you for your call. Let's go to Dick in South Ozone Park. Hello, Dick.
Hi, Steve. A pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you.
I got about a minute of comment.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
I like this man. He pre-timed his comment.
All right. Bob will be missed by me and, of course, all of his fans. However, I think book sales should grow throughout the country because Bob went national several months
to be honest, I can't even say if this book is being distributed on a national basis. I'd be surprised. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't even know if it is. But anyway, go ahead.
He may have mentioned it. Also, I believe it was last year that he signed a new multi-year contract with John Minnelli and ABC. And if they break the contract, he'll do very well monetarily. I also think that he'll be picked up by one of the stations that was on his national network if he's not picked up by another New York station.
All right, Dick, thank you for the call.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to Rick in Mount Vernon. Rick, you're on 770 WABC.
Hi, Steve.
Hi.
Hi. I know the Devil's theme song.
Oh, okay. What is
that? That is Gary Glitter on... originally came out on Bell Records. That is Rock and Roll Part 2.
That's it.
And
Rock and Roll Part 2, Gary Glitter.
And
you're
I'm
right.
Glad the Devils didn't make it. They should leave. They should move to Colorado. And as far as Bob goes, he's coming back.
All right, thanks
Bob
for the
will be back.
Dick, thanks for the call. Rick, thanks for the call. Right in Riverdale, Ray, you're on 770 WABC.
How you doing? I just want to say I'm outraged that Disney can do this. And frankly, for a guy who had such a, you know, was a people person, warm-hearted, had such a... No, really good speaking.
Goodbye. Let's go to Herb in New Jersey. Hello, Herb. You're on 770 WABC.
Steve, I'm a longtime listener from way back WMCA, the Strauss family, the Goombah from Yonkers. I'm sure you remember. I've got an idea for Bob and the FM station that Howard Stern is on. I think it's it could be a marriage made in heaven. Let that FM station pick up Bob, put him in that time slot. He doesn't have to go 4 hours. Let him go from 4 to 7. He will dominate as Howard does. Imus can't get near him. Lionel can't get near him. And that's my thought for
all
today.
All right, I appreciate it, Herb. We go to Jillian in Short Hills. Hello, Jillian.
Yeah, hi. I just want to say it's a wonderful day in America. I am glad that Eisner, Disney, Mickey Mouse, the whole bit and caboodle have the guts to get rid of Bob Grant. I'm tired of people whining and whimpering when you make the comment that he made regarding Ron Brown. Entertainment or not, that was a despicable comment. There is no justification and no excuse for it.
He apologized.
I know he did, Steve, but what I'm saying is that there was no excuse. I mean, Bob Dole goes around waving that arm with regards to his service to this country, and here you have Ron Brown dying in service to this country.
What does Bob Dole waving his arm have to do with anything? As you put it, first of all, he can't lift the arm, Jillian, so I don't know how he waves it.
Okay, well, first of all, he goes around throwing an arm up.
Yeah, all right, goodbye. Now he throws it up. Let's go to Alex in Rockland County. Hello, Alex. You're on 770 WABC.
Yeah, hi, Steve.
He throws it around. He waves it. Next, you'll say he takes it off and throws it. Yeah.
Yeah. And he probably shakes people's hands with it, too.
Right.
It's sad. It was shocking news, and everybody's up in arms and confused about what to say. I didn't hear the whole afternoon. I just heard the last couple of hours, and when you said that he left the radio station with his head up high, as staunch as he ever was, it just comes to pass in my memory. I mean, I can almost repeat it verbatim because he said it so many times, that the day that he is told what opinions he's allowed to express and what opinions not, he will no longer work for that radio station. I'm just surmising that this may have brought about the fact that he left, especially the way the statement by Phil Boyce was put forth. And that's probably why he's holding his head high.
All right, Alex, thank you. Let's go try to get Tim in real quick. Hi, Tim. You're on 77 WABC.
Hi, Steve. How you doing? I'd just like to say I hope you don't hang up on me because you don't like what
happened. I haven't hung up on anybody. She was making fun of Bob Dole's arm.
Yeah, that was totally uncalled for on her part. But I think she had a legitimate point. I think Bob Grant was the doddering old man whose sole agenda was to focus on populist paranoia and xenophobia in a city that's already wrought with violence and hatred to begin with. And I don't think it's such a big deal that it was a loss, you know, that he's off the air. I have listened to him incessantly for years.
Well, he must be doing something right then if he had you listening to him.
Yeah, I have to say that he was definitely...
Jim, I'm out of time. I didn't hang up on you. Thanks for your call. Steve Malzberg, stay tuned for Curtis. I'm in for Jay again tomorrow at 10:05. And if you're listening, Bob, God bless.
More Americans listen to this radio station than any other talk radio station in the nation.
WABC New York.
It's 2 o'clock.
And at 8 minutes after the hour of 2, no, I'm not tired yet, as I go round the clock. Unexpectedly, at 2 o'clock this past afternoon, I was informed with so many others that WABC, which has come to mean always be careful. You know, we've joked about that from time to time, and I've mentioned to you that often when I push the envelope, when I really push it to the edge and I go into battle and all caution is left behind, that at any given point the guillotine can drop, no matter who you are in the talk radio world. And it's interesting because at 2 o'clock I was asked to stand by the management here at WABC, and I could look and see in the eye of Phil Boyce that he was troubled, that indeed what was taking place was something on the unusual, bordering on the unordinary. And you could see with a heavy heart as he went back into his hovel there, and then moments later, Bob Grant, the king of talk radio, was to enter. The door was closed. There were no loud voices. But when all was said and done, whatever the private conversation was, Bob Grant exited, his head held high, his chin jutting out, and he came to each and every one of us, and he said, "You know, I've had a great ride here at WABC, but they've told me it's over." Not a tear was shed. His back was straight. Posture was magnificent. He was not at all a beaten man. In fact, you could tell the experience of having gone through this before on many an occasion was right then and there surfacing. And then management turned to me in the face of Phil Boyce, and with tears streaming down his face, unable to hold back the feelings of emotion that obviously had to be welling deep inside that giant of a man for the more than 24 hours when he must have, in a very tortured way, known that he would have to be the messenger of bad news. And proverbially, like the Turk in professional football, who has to come and ask that the star quarterback or the star figure, or in this case, sort of the George Blanda of WABC, the man who literally rescued this format from the abyss, when they were literally talking about possibly reverting WABC back to the old format, the tried and true format of so many decades ago, when it was the number one top 40 record-playing station in the nation. Bob Grant, who through perseverance, through sheer will, through his understanding of the power of talk, took that fledgling concept, pushed it as hard as it could possibly be pushed, and turned WABC for a time almost single-handedly into the number one talk station in the nation. And yes, many of you will say, well, there was Rush. Yes, Rush came along, but it was in the shadow of Bob Grant. Oh, yeah, well, there was Ed Koch. Yeah, he hooked his reputation onto this station, but well after the ascent of talk radio. And it was Bob Grant always pioneering, always a force to be reckoned with, a legend in his time and in the annals of radio history, a legend and a friend for so many of us for all times. The seriousness of this determination by the management here at WABC, not at the level you think, not at the program director's level, Phil Boyce, or the general manager's level, Don Belukis. This decision was further up in that corporate structure. Indeed it is. In fact, I'm looking at newspapers that 99.9% of you have not had a chance yet to lay your eyes on. I'm talking about the Thursday edition of the New York Post, and on the front cover it says, "Grant's Tomb. ABC Axis top radio host in uproar over a death joke." That's the title. Then the subtitles, "Grant no longer radioactive. WABC Axis host for crack about Ron Brown. Show was a litany of many responses." And apparently, if we are to believe the New York Post, this decision was made at the highest of levels. In fact, they quote ABC President Robert Iger. And I can tell you that neither Phil Boyce, program director, or general manager Don Belukis are anywhere near that level of management. We're talking the highest levels. You can't go much higher than that. We're talking you need an oxygen mask when you get up into that atmospheric condition of corporate responsibility. The New York Times feels it so important, it's also on its front page. Bob Grant is off-air following remarks on Brown's death in Thursday's New York Times. And in all the copy that's been written, in all the commentary that's emerging, in all the TV stories about this unexpected dropping of the guillotine on the career of Bob Grant, our friend, our mentor here, no one has mentioned that Bob Grant had apologized, said he was sorry for that on-air remark last Thursday that was criticized as cruelly insensitive to the late Commerce Secretary Ron Brown. Maybe you remember, like I do, I remember listening to it when he told you, the listeners, the day of Brown's fatal plane crash, that if there was a survivor, he figured it would be Brown because I'm a pessimist. Animus would say something like that, or something flippant along those lines. So would Howard Stern and others. And yes, if you look at their background, on occasion, they've lost their jobs, been given the pink slip, even though they were riding high in the saddle, making millions of dollars for their respective stations. Who can ever forget that? Who can ever forget the fact that Howard Stern was literally off the radio dial for many, many months before he reemerged? Don Imus was exiled out of New York, ended up in Cleveland, got about as low as one could on the personal pole of credibility and also in terms of professional broadcasting standards, but came back like Lazarus from the dead. Bob Grant doesn't fit into any of those categories because, unlike his colleagues, Imus and Stern, remember, Bob Grant has been through this for many decades. He's been fired before under just such sets of circumstances. Originally at WMCA when he was brought here by the Strauss family, oh, it seems like eons ago, at WOR. In fact, I remember visiting Bob Grant at radio station WWDB in Philadelphia because he could not find employment in the New York market. The king of talk radio, nobody has attracted the cume, the large audience of drive time that Bob Grant has for so many years in talk radio. And yet, when he was exiled virtually 20 years ago, he could only pick up work at WWDB. Oh, yeah, they allowed him to come back in on Saturday afternoons and host a program on WMCA. And then eventually, when WABC reverted its schedule from spinning stacks of wax to talk radio, they decided to sign him on board and make him the linchpin of that successful strategy. And you know something? Bob Grant, who took this right on the chin but didn't go down to his knee, said it wouldn't be a TKO, it wouldn't be a knockout, life would continue, has pointed out to us here, the junior members of the talk radio programs here that you hear on WABC, has pointed out how we ourselves have lost our jobs in the past. Hey, yours truly. I got fired unexpectedly, remember? We were riding high in the saddle, Lisa and myself, in the mornings. We're scoring all kinds of record numbers. They never before had ratings like that in the mornings. And then you remember Carl Kush? Boom, the guillotine. One morning, John Minnelli asked us to come into his office, how he had so many times before that, sat us down and said, hey, you had a 3-year run on Broadway. We're going in a different direction. Boom, slam, bam, thank you, ma'am. Gone, out. Ed Koch, remember he was fired from Channel 2 Sunday's edition. Remember, he made that program. I mean, the only reason you watched it was because of Ed Koch and because of all of his outrageous comments. And because it was determined that he had made some kind of a slur towards Congressman Charlie Rangel, and Charlie Rangel was complaining, they fired Ed Koch. And that program has never, ever returned to the kind of listenership and those viewing it as at the time of Ed Koch, when he used to speak and make headlines the next day on Channel 2 Sunday edition. Lynn Samuels, fired from WABC, remember? Steve MARLSBERG, fired, only to come back. Jay Diamond, fired, only to come back. Yours truly, Curtis Lee, were fired. Dick Oliver, fired at WOR when he had the very successful format of the Bulldog edition, remember? He was competing against Bob Grant late at night. I believe it was from 5 to 7 when he would intro to you what would be in the pages of the Daily News the very next day. Fired. They scuttled the format. Few, if any, of the talk show hosts here have not suffered the indignity of getting a pink slip. Rush had so many pink slips, he ran out of the pink slips. That's how many places he got fired from before he finally found his stride and became the Mega Rush man. Only Lionel has not suffered that indignity. And you know something? Like the king told me long ago, you have not established yourself in talk radio until you've been fired and rejected and dumped on your tuchus. And the true measure of you will be as they taunt you, as they dance on your grave, as they dance on your bones to come back again, swinging and winging. And that's the attitude he had when he left late in the day. Management didn't hustle him out. They didn't tell him, hey, you got an hour left. Clean out your drawers. Make sure you don't leave any valuables behind. He still has his office here. He'll still be receiving your mail. If you would like to fax to him any messages, I've just changed the fax roll. We've had 4 fax rolls alone since I made the announcement right after the Yankee game at about 4:30. And the faxes have been pouring in fast and furiously. I promise to all of you I will personally place it into his hands or into the hands of Phil Boyce if it's directed to management. And naturally, I'll read those faxes to all of you. 212-947-1340, the fax line. That's 212-947-1340. Phone lines are already all lit up as they have been ever since I was called upon to make that announcement back at 4:30 this past day. I was bewildered. I was shaken. I was confused. I had to bring this terrible news that was not at all comforting to his legions of fans. And as is the tradition of my religious upbringing, I had to ask all of them for an act of absolution, as I'm asking all of you. For the 42 years that I've lived my life, from time to time when faced with situations such as what I walked into earlier this past day, I've had to ball up my fists and continuously strike my chest and whisper to myself, like so many of you have, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault, as I had to cite to everyone that the King of Talk Radio, their friend, their pal, their guiding light, their patriot, would no longer broadcast here from the radio station WABC. When we come back, ladies and gentlemen, I will share with you some of the calls I received off the air. Oh, yes, there were some people who were reveling at the fact that Bob Grant had been mutually given an opportunity to resign, whatever terminology, and I'll give you the exact terminology that was issued by the suits and by Bob Grant and his manager. It was a collaborative effort. But whatever words or terminology you use, there were buzzards and vultures circling. They smelled blood, and the piranhas were biting fast and furiously. And they decided to call me. I'll let you know who these people were. They gave me a message. They say, we came for Jay, and we took care of Jay. Then we came for the king, and we kicked him off the throne. And if you don't watch your P's and Q's, Sliwa, we're coming for you. Because we're running out of people to come after. I bet you'd like to know who those people were who had the gall, the tenacity, the chutzpah to pick up a phone and talk to me directly off air right after I had to drop the bomb and let you all know of management's decision. We're from Yonkers.
Hi, Curtis. I just want to tell you that you are a very beautiful, warm person. I heard you this afternoon when I was driving in my car, and it was the saddest moment. It was like when Jay lost his job, you lost your job, and now Bob. And I just have to wonder about the people that did it. There's a couple of things that I want to talk to you about. There's a flyer going around. But anyway, let me just read this little thing I wrote. Bob sees a sin, full treacherous act of humanity, and knows it should be punished. He sees a life and knows it's abused or if it's abusive. He hears liars and knows they should repent and confess the truth. He feels a feeling of discomfort with those who are shamefully malcontent. He calls a bird, a bow, and a dog. Some condemn him on the basis that the bird shouldn't fly. It's a Republican or a conservative, so clip its wings. A bow is nothing. Who cares about bows? They're like helpless people. And a dog is something that only barks. Even when it did bark, some would never admit it. And so I have to say, Mario can say what he wants, then neutralize it in his own way, politically correct and charming. The opinion of Newfield's words travels through the newspapers and read by many. So why not Grant? Is it because he is such a giant, not prejudiced? He didn't want to zip his lip. Are we in a communist country? What the phonies wish is that he was a bigot and a racist and not fair with an opinion and a lifelong promise of glory, because that's what he wants us to have, because he thinks we're good people and we deserve it. He's a purist. So no matter what the color, religion, or persuasion, you cannot mistake that if you're open-minded and fair. And I just think these people who don't like him are backbiting, jealous, harmful zealots, and they're fearful of the truth. I got a hold of a flyer, and you have to think to yourself when you stop a person like Bob, who is intelligent and who does say what is the way that it is, how is it that these flyers can go around, these same people? Now, this is Angela Jordan Davis.
Yes.
Jackson, did you see the flyer?
Yes, I've seen that flyer and many other flyers similar to it.
Because I've never seen the National Rainbow Coalition flyer. And on the bottom of it, it says Motor Voter Alert. I don't know if you saw that one.
Yes.
Alan Simpson of Wyoming, and they're talking about him picking on Latinos. Now, let me ask you, who are the people who are the bigots? Are the Latinos the only people coming into this country? But they single this out, and they want us to oppose to Simpson's motor voter proof of citizenship. So these people are the people that start the trouble, and then they want to take Bob Grant and take him off the air.
Maria of Yonkers, that the big flap in the newspapers that you'll see in the morning, or at least the excuse that is being given or surmised by most, is that the ABC axed Bob Grant in the uproar over his statement about the death of Commerce Secretary Ron Brown. That might well be true. I don't know the inner workings or what the inner thought processes were, but I do know that none of these stories mention how he took to the airwaves last Thursday, reiterated, if I remember, some of his criticisms of Ron Brown, the Commerce Secretary, as the politician, as the appointed official, but said he did not wish him dead. And if I remember properly, if I hope I'm quoting him properly, said he was sorry he said it because so many people took it the wrong way. I mean, he apologized. How many people come over the airwaves and apologize for things that they've said? Few, if any.
That's right. And then why are some people forgiven for the little statements, which are really not so terrible when you think about them, because maybe the person is thinking of something else that this person did, and they make this little comment. What are we supposed to do, walk on eggs and tie our tongues to trees because only some people are allowed to say things and other people aren't?
Yeah, but Marie,
what about Jesse Jackson, all the terrible things he says?
All right, but it was a formidable list of adversaries that Bob Grant would face off with on a regular basis. Alan Dershowitz, the pit bull terrier, who just has an attitude of onward, battle through, regardless of how much collateral damage he takes to his own character. Mario Cuomo, who you mentioned, Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson. In fact, let me reveal to all of you, Marie, that phone call I received right after the program that was put through by the switchboard operator came from the one of the associates, sort of right-hand man of Al Sharpton. He's now a reverend. Like C. Vernon Mason just became a reverend, you know, instant collar, reverendship. The Reverend Carl Redding, and with Al Sharpton in the background, I could have swore. I could have swore, Marie, that there was that cackling laugh. I know Al Sharpton's voice well. I've been facing off with him adversarially for almost as long as Bob Grant has been on the airwaves here in New York. And they were dancing on his grave. And then telling me that first it was Jay, next it was the King, and they've got me in their eyesights.
Well, you know, Curtis, WABC really has a family there. I don't care if we agree or we disagree with everybody. You can't always agree with anybody that you know.
Yes.
And it's just a wonderful family. It's marvelous. I leave the radio on all the time when I'm here. If I'm sleeping and I wake up, it's on. It's on in the car when I'm driving to and from work. And I love each of you that have a show. In your own way, you have your own opinions, and that's what we need.
Mm.
And they say that this is not like a death. Sure, it's not a death of a person, but it certainly is a death of a voice. And it is the saddest, saddest thing to have to go through this and see that we're living in a country where you have to walk under a certain banner, and then maybe you can be heard. But he cannot be heard.
Well, Marie, you have been a tried and true listener here to WABC, and I'm sure your heartfelt feelings towards Bob are reflected by many who are either unable to call or...
WABC management, senior program director Phil Boyce, have frequently defended Bob Grant, and it sort of took me by surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Despite there's Bob Grant has been controversial forever, and I don't know that his comments recently were any more controversial than anything else he has ever said. For it to come now, I think most people are speculating, can only have to do with the new management at ABC, Capital Cities ABC,
mm-hmm.
Namely the Disney folks who now are in control.
You know, some of the most outrageous things are said on other stations, and I would give you Stern, I would give you Imus, I would give you WLIB. Outrageous things, not only by the hosts, but by the callers. And no mention is made of it. Why is this?
There are some who would argue that it has to do with politics. There are some who would say that Grant took it on the chin simply because of his conservative views.
Mm-hmm.
It could also be because when people such as Stern or Imus say things, it's understood,
mm-hmm.
perhaps, that they're trying to do it in a sense of humor, whereas with a show like Bob's, it was often in the context of current events and news and politics, and people took him a lot more seriously than they take a Howard Stern or a Don Imus.
What I don't understand is Bob Grant never posed as a journalist, per se, as a reporter such as you are. He was a commentator. He was an opinion former and maker. He was a guy who sought to change opinion, sought to be political, be conservative. Why has he been regarded as some kind of a warped reporter? I don't understand that either.
Well, that's a good question. I don't quite know. I think it's because of the fact that he does... I think Bob often fell victim of not being cautious enough in these cautious times. I mean,
mm-hmm.
Rush Limbaugh's had troubles like that, but he is much more establishment than Bob Grant ever has been. Bob Grant says things from as they come into his brain, and perhaps he should have thought more carefully about something.
I think you just hit on something. These cautious times. What does this mean? Are we going to just keep losing voices out there?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think there's still a wide tolerance
mm-hmm.
of diversity, of diverse viewpoints on radio. You have people such as G. Gordon Liddy and Oliver North who espouse viewpoints that in often cases are far more to the right than Bob Grant has
mm-hmm.
ever been. And they still continue to be on there. And I think Bob Grant will soon find a place elsewhere on the radio dial. I think this was simply a case of a company such as Walt Disney, which has a certain corporate image, not wanting to be associated with a man that a number of people, rightly or wrongly, find offensive.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that despite denials by some ABC management, I think this was simply a Disney decision. But, of course, I'll never know.
Want to join with me and we'll take a few calls from our listeners?
Sure thing.
Joe Adalian is my guest, and he writes for the New York Post. Let's go to Sam in Queens. Sam, you're on 770 WABC.
How are you?
Good.
Thank you for having me on. All I want to say is I started listening to WABC radio about a year ago, thanks to my father-in-law, Gus Lodato.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess it made me see the light of what's going on out there. And I have to give 100% of the credit to Bob Grant. I was seeing exactly what's going on out there. He educated me. He let me see the light. He let me know what's going on with politics and all of these... all the bad things that are happening.
Even when you didn't agree with him.
I didn't agree with maybe 100% of the stuff
right.
that he said.
Right.
But I agree with a lot of it.
Uh-huh.
But he let me see exactly what's going on with the liberal media, with the conservative movement and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And especially with Bill Clinton and his Whitewater. I mean, I thought he was the greatest guy, and I voted for him. And he let me see exactly who this man was.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And I give him a lot of that credit. And you know what? What happened to him this weekend is only going to make him more powerful, and it's going to make him greater. And people are going to see that he's not the racist that he really is. And it's going to be amazing what's going to happen. It's only going to make him more bigger and more powerful, and especially with this next election coming up.
All right. Thank you, Sam. Joe Dallion, you think this thing is political?
Is there politics involved? Perhaps, but, you know, WABC and Disney, which owns WABC, has Rush Limbaugh and there are lots of other conservative hosts. I don't think they took him off simply because Bob Grant has conservative viewpoints. There are conservative viewpoints all over WABC, and there will continue to be even after Bob Grant is gone. I think this was simply the result of a very organized effort by a lot of Grant's detractors, you know, all sorts of media activists, Alan Dershowitz.
Mm-hmm.
There's this one guy, Scott Pellegrino, who's been active in trying to get the guy off the air, fairness and accuracy in reporting. They focus a spotlight on it, and for whatever reason, Disney apparently decided that the spotlight was too hot for them to handle and made a decision.
All right, let's take another call. Paul on Long Island. Paul, you're on 770 WABC.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm kind of outraged by the decision by management on Bob Grant. I also think that it was because he was an effective conservative voice.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, there were people attacking him, and he was under attack. You could get a fair and honest opinion from Mr. Grant, which you can't get from the real media. I mean, is there any doubt who Jennings, Brokaw, and Rather will vote for in this next election? Are they objective in their news reporting? Is the liberal media at all objective? They put a dagger through Grant. They were after Grant, and they got him. Conservatives are under attack in the media. It's, you know, even Imus, when he was at the White House dinner, you know, he spoke the truth. He was attacked. You know,
he made a dope out of himself down at that dinner.
Well, Hillary couldn't seem to find the papers, right, for years.
Well,
all of a sudden they showed up.
You have respect for the presidency, if not the president.
Well, you know, the president was the guy that came on Imus and started laughing about, having a pickup truck with blankets in the back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the president's the guy that answered about what kind of underwear he wears.
All right.
You know, it was just an attack on conservative values and conservative principles. I mean, Dick, for example, I mean, is there any doubt who you're going to vote for in the next election?
Yeah, sure is. I don't know.
I don't think so.
I don't know. I really don't know. I thank you, Paul. Now I'm a liberal. The other guy, next guy, called me a conservative. Joe, it ain't easy here on a Thursday.
Well, I mean, I think there are a lot of your callers are right to identify that there is obviously an establishment mentality that perhaps tilts to the left and treats someone like Bob Grant with disdain. But I don't really think in this situation you can say it was politics. I mean, politics played a part, no doubt. But you know, Rush Limbaugh is still on the air, and so are a bunch of other very conservative people. I think this was a case of Bob Grant simply not being sensitive enough for these times. And I just don't know if it's the right decision.
Joe, I want to thank you for spending this time with us.
Thanks, Dick.
Joe Dallion of the New York Post. You'll find his story in today's editions. We'll continue to take your calls here on 770 WABC. Stay with us.
Well, here I am, head coach, the voice of reason. Let me talk about the Bob Grant situation, and hopefully it won't occupy the whole program, but there's no question that it is a matter that's on the minds of lots of people, including my own. The papers make it very clear that over the years, his remarks included not only vulgar, which I have referred to, I've said he was a vulgar man, and he is, but some of the remarks clearly are racist. I'm reading from the New York Times. At various times in the past few years, Mr. Grant has used a crude sexual epithet referring to Dr. Martin Luther King, also described former Mayor David Dinkins as a washroom attendant, that if the baseball star Magic Johnson, who was HIV positive, developed AIDS and deteriorated, then he would make, quote, a contribution to society. And then, of course, you had the terrible thing that he said about Ron Brown. And then his apology on that was not really an apology. He said people took it the wrong way. How else could you take it other than you wished him dead? Now, having said all of that, I've been mulling it over in my head. The FCC's rule, as it relates to what commentators can say, without violating FCC rules is that they can say anything except engage in language that includes seven scatological words involving body functions and sex. Other than that, they have radio stations out west where people are racist and anti-Semitic and a whole host of terrible, terrible things. And then it becomes a question as to whether or not the employer, which is the radio station, believes its income is being affected. And there is no First Amendment right here. It's not a question of the government shutting anybody down. It's that an employer, whether it's a newspaper or a radio station, has a right to say, well, my bottom line, which is my income, is being adversely affected, and then they can make a decision any way they want to with respect to who they will keep in their employment, in this case, on the air. Now, what's troublesome to me is this. Where does it stop? If you're not talking about the bottom line, where the employer says this adversely affects me and therefore I don't want to do it and I'm personally offended, and if it didn't adversely affect me, I'd allow the normal course to take its place if people stop listening. But they're not going to stop listening in the case of Bob Grant, because there is a built-in audience for the Bob Grants and the Pat Buchanans and the Father Coughlins and the Charles Lindberghs that involve those who either use all of the anti-attacks, anti-black, anti-Semitic, anti-gay, anti-women, anti-immigrant, anti-foreigner, or just a part of them. And maybe 25% of America participates in that kind of bashing of other groups. But the real question is, do we want to cut people off this way? Because where does it end? I mean, every single commentator, whether it's myself or Mario Cuomo or any of the other very able people on WABC or WOR, I mean, I don't listen to these people because I'm doing other things when I'm not on the radio, but I'm sure many of them are extremely able. And if you're able, you're going to take strong positions, and people are not going to like them. Should we see all these people taken off as commentators because the blacks don't like them, or the Jews don't like them, or the Italians don't like them, or whites don't like them in general, whatever it happens to be? I don't think so. I think it's bad. And so that's my position. Doesn't mean that the station doesn't have the right and isn't doing what's reasonable and responsible when its bottom line, which is its income, is involved. Not supposed to be in the business of losing money because it puts on somebody who doesn't attract sponsors because they're being boycotted. But these boycotts are very dangerous. So that's my position on that.
I think that they've fallen into pressures from Dershowitz and
But how about the pressures? I'm now trying to argue like the attorney for the devil here. You have what's the name of the guy who they did fire first? Dershowitz. Did you protest their firing Dershowitz?
No.
Did you? Would you?
Would I?
Yeah.
If I was on that team?
No, that's the point. You're making my point that if you would support what the guy has to say, then you're going to call up and you're going to say you shouldn't fire him. That's not good enough in my book. In my book, there is a fundamental question. Do you want to allow controversial statements? In your case, you didn't give a rap that they removed the controversial statements of Dershowitz. You only care that they remove the controversial statements of Bob Grant. Isn't that correct?
Mr. Koch.
Yeah.
Mr. Koch, may I answer that question?
Please.
And then move on to something similar?
Go ahead.
Okay. Yes, you're correct.
Okay.
But also on the other end of the dial, and I care not to enter the letters, there is such a despicable conversations that carry on about what is going on with America and about white people. It's despicable, but nobody talks about that.
Of course they talk about that. Now, that's the... Now, stop.
Ed,
no, you stop or you won't be on here.
Go ahead.
The fact is that WLIB fired somebody. I think it's WLIB, because there was an uproar as it related to black anti-Semitism. I don't know whether it makes sense. I think what makes sense is to either argue with those people or not to listen. And when you don't listen and the listening audience goes down, then the employer has the right to say, well, this guy or woman isn't drawing any people and I'm losing money, so I'm going to get somebody else. But to simply continue to listen and bring pressure on the employer to fire, I don't think that's helpful to our discussion opportunities. What do you think?
Well, you're right about that, Mr. Koch, and I continue to listen to you when I'm available to the radio.
That's because you like what I say.
Well, you want to know something? I feel that you're a relatively fair individual.
No, listen, I know I am. I'm the voice of common sense. I'm a liberal with sanity, and I say things that irritate lots of people who don't like the controversies that I get into. For example, I'm opposed to any racial... program that eliminates white males. You love that. I don't do it because I want to favor white males. I want to prevent them from being excluded. I also believe that there is racial discrimination against blacks. I think it's horrible that taxi drivers don't pick up the black standing on a street corner for whatever reason. But on the other hand, you don't care about that part. You only care about the things that I say that you like, and that's why what you said has little relevancy or resonance for me. This is Ed Koch, your voice of reason on 770 WABC.
Because of an event that happened here yesterday, and please indulge me as we go through this. In fact, many of you have probably heard about this in the course of the morning as you've informed yourself, however you do that, newspapers, other radio programs. New York's leading radio talk show host, Bob Grant, a veteran of decades in this business. What was it, 45 years he's been on the air, something like that, in a number of markets around the country, and most recently and most prominently here in New York City, left WABC yesterday. It was said by mutual agreement with the management of WABC Radio, our flagship station here in New York City, and himself. Now, I heard of this. The buzz on this started yesterday afternoon about 2:30 Eastern Time. I got a little, during a commercial break, I got a little note here in my IFB which informed me of this. And there was shock and panic throughout the, panic. There was this stunned surprise in many quarters throughout the whole station. As I was leaving the EIB broadcast studios and the golden EIB microphone to walk back down the hall to my office, which is two blocks away, just inside a building, I saw Bob, after he had just been informed, not much sooner than 2:30. So we met in the hall, and he told me what had happened as though I had not known it. He was breaking news to me. And I sat and talked to him for about, I'd say 20 minutes in the hall about what had happened. And he was admittedly in a state of shock over what had happened. That's what he said to me. And I've received a whole lot of mail in my electronic mailbox from people commenting on this. And here in New York today, actually from last night on this station, the sole topic of discussion has been what has happened. And it basically is centered on free speech and the fact that Bob Grant now, according to many, has been censored, that liberal critics of Bob Grant have won, that this is a bad day for free speech and conservatism in America, and what are we going to do about it? How can this is just not right. Now, let me say something here. I want to say many things about this, but first and foremost, let me tell all of you who are ardent Bob Grant fans, those of you who love him and have been part of his life on the radio for all these years, the one thing Bob Grant is and has always been is a professional, a broadcast and particularly a radio broadcast professional. I have, over the course of the months and years that I have been behind this microphone, I have commented often on corporate life. I have commented often on the status of the employee versus management. I have oftentimes been accused of being insensitive. People have said that I have no common ground with the average common man because I don't understand what tumultuous circumstances average people face. And I've often responded by saying, oh no, I've probably been fired more times than many of you have. And Bob Grant has too. And that's what I mean about saying Bob Grant is a radio and a broadcast professional. If you slice it all away, if you get down to the bare bones, for those of you here in the tri-state area, there is no such thing as free speech when you work for someone else. And all of us in broadcasting know it. You get fired your first time and you learn it. You get fired the second and third time and you have it confirmed. And after, depends on how many times it takes you to figure it out, but it usually doesn't take very many, you understand that you do work, and I think that it's wise for everybody to remember this, no matter what business you're in, that you work at the pleasure of the people who pay you. And they can summarily dismiss you at any time, for any reason. Now, Bob Grant is not going to be able to go to court like some in our country can. Bob Grant's not going to be able to get a lawyer and say he was unfairly dismissed. He's not going to be able to go to some union and cause all sorts of grief. That's an option that doesn't exist here, especially for these circumstances. I want you to know that Bob Grant knows this. And Bob Grant took this, although he admitted to being in shock, he took this as the seasoned veteran and professional he is. I have a sneaking suspicion that Bob Grant's going to pop up back on the radio in this town real soon, ladies and gentlemen, in a triumphant way. Bob Grant may not think so today. You seldom do after this sort of thing happens to you, but I happen to suspect that that will be the case. The specifics of why management decided to terminate Bob Grant are interesting. They are fascinating, and they clearly would represent a lot of unfairness. For example, in this city, there are radio personalities who routinely wish for hundreds of people to die. There are people in this town who wish and say constantly on the air, I hope so-and-so gets AIDS. I hope so-and-so gets stuck up with a needle. These people so far have been allowed to get away with this kind of thing and have really not been punished for it, publicly reprimanded. Nor do any of the groups protesting Bob Grant protest these other people who say the same things. And Grant made one slip of the tongue along these lines and apologized for it, which is something that few, I refer you to Bryant Gumbel, will do when they feel that they have erred. But Grant apologized and did what he thought was in everyone's best interests after controversial situations arose. But you can sit here and cry about the double standard all you want. It doesn't deny the reality. The reality is that the particular management here at WABC didn't want this sort of thing, as they heard it, going on around them. It's their right and their prerogative. They are the owners. They are the investors. It's their radio station. And it's their airwaves. We may think it's the public airwaves, and therefore that you're entitled to listen to whatever you want to, but it's the people who own the broadcast license and the frequency and the broadcast outlet. They're the ones who own it. Go to work at McDonald's and tell them you're not going to wear the cap, and you're not going to cook the hamburgers the way they say, and see how long you last. And you can say, well, freedom of speech, my creativity has been denied. Well, it may be so, but McDonald's has a certain way of having their employees dress and fix hamburgers. If you don't do it, you're gone. It's the way of the world. There are others in this town, on radio, who are gutless wonders. Bob Grant at least told you what he thought. Bob Grant at least stood firm in his principles and beliefs, and he didn't waver from them. Told you exactly what he believed every day. And that makes a lot of people nervous.
There are cowards on the air in this town who don't have the guts to tell you what they think, but they'll disguise what they think in the voices of others. And they'll put words that others have never said into voices imitating these people, parody songs and so forth. No basis in truth whatsoever, that routinely defame and criticize and malign and impugn. And they apparently are allowed to get away with it with no punishment or reprimand whatsoever. I think the difference is that the people I'm talking about in this town who do these things to get away with it are perceived as liberals. They're perceived as progressive members of the elite, and so they're funny. Bob Grant is conservative. Bob Grant poked fun and was hard-hitting at targets that you're not supposed to aim at. Targets on the left. Protected groups. Can't criticize them, can't comment on them. And for this, the rabble got very loud, was raised quite a bit, and management responded to it as they did. This is all part of life. It's all part of this business. It happens to virtually everybody in this business. It's not ever going to stop. It is part of what you learn when you enter this business. It is part of defining you as a professional. And it's a measure of your character as to how you deal with it. Bob Grant is dealing with this in as professional a manner as it is possible to deal with. And I again, fully expect that he'll be resurfacing in this market in a prominent place very soon, as soon as he wants to. So don't cry for him, and don't really cry for free speech. It's a misnomer. There's a lot of things that have happened here in talk radio over the years because of its recent prominence, and people think that there is a constitutional right to say whatever you want whenever you want to say it, and there's not. I have never been under any illusion that what protects me, for example, in my position, is the First Amendment. It doesn't. It never has. Throughout my entire broadcast career, and it's not going to start protecting me now. There are other things. In fact, you really can't get protection. You can get insurance. You can structure yourself. And by the way, in that regard, Bob Grant had done everything that was asked of him. He delivered the largest audience in New York radio in the afternoon. His program was sold out, so it was a business and financial success in every measure that this industry considers important. But there were other considerations that the management of the station felt were more important and acted on them. That is their right. Doesn't mean that they are right, and it doesn't mean that they've done the right thing, but they are the boss. They run it and can do whatever they wish. And if this sounds cold and callous, I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, but it is just the voice of the experiences I have faced myself as an adult in the working world. We are all working stiffs. If someone on the radio actually wants to be able to say anything they want at any time, then they have to own the outlet on which they are broadcasting. If you don't, you're always going to be subject to the whims, be they reasonable or unreasonable, of those for whom you work. Bob Grant knows this. And I'm sure he feels like he was treated unfairly, like he was defeated by enemies that don't deserve to win, and I feel the same way. But it's happened, and he'll be fine and deal with it, I think, in a way that'll make all of his listeners and fans proud. You wait. Quick break, back with more after this.
You're listening to the EIB Network on 770 WABC.
Thank you.
And at 10 minutes after the hour of 3, this is yours truly, Curtis SLIWA, rejoining all of our friends and many listeners out there in the land that receives the 50,000 powerful watts of sound. The song I chose to begin the program with today, Staying Alive, has a lot to do with what has been taking place, not just with myself, but my other colleagues here at WABC, because it's given us an opportunity to reflect on our own careers, on the instability that exists in this industry, on the career path that many have chosen. And whereas I am so honored once again to be speaking to the greatest talk radio audience of all time at the number one talk station in the nation, I've had a chance to talk to many of those individuals who have made it such and find out how difficult it has been for them through these past few years of reaching the top rung of success in the talk radio field. Prior to arriving at WABC this morning from a speaking engagement I was attending, I bumped into a person who's become very familiar to all of you in the tri-state radio listening area, Jim Kerr. You've heard him from time to time, substitute for Rush Limbaugh on the National EIB Network show. And he became a familiar face around here at WABC because for a long time he was the morning show host at our sister station, WPLJ, and has done long stints at WYNY and Mix 105, a veteran. I mean, he wears the tag vet. And there I met him in the street and he said, "That's right, cut loose once again, unemployed."